So I had offered earlier this week, I'm like, well, I mean, I could work on a message or I could sing. And then I was told, well, no, we have a plan. And apparently there was a plan. Wow. How sweet to be in the Lord's presence. So clear this morning. The baptism with the glory to the Lord. It's just sweet to worship Him together. So I'm supposed to say stuff now and just trying to pull it together after all that. It was great. Good morning, everybody. It's good to be with God's people, to be in His house, to be under the authority and the leadership of His Word, His Son, Jesus Christ. There's not another reason to gather, but I'm excited that we've gathered for that purpose today. We are finishing, believe it or not, we're going to do it. Lord willing, we're going to finish Colossians. And today, and then next weekend, are the last two messages from this book of Colossians. And the Lord has been so perfect in His timing. Every week we come to the passage, we're like, well, that's perfect for today, and I believe we're there again today. Just a quick reminder, some of the themes we've been through in Colossians, we don't want to just be hearers of the word, we want to be doers, right? So it's calling to mind some of the things the Lord has already shown us so clearly early in the book of Colossians, the clear supremacy of Jesus Christ. He's the image of the invisible God. Firstborn of all creation. Unbelievable truth. We were reminded in chapter 3, after so much theology, those first couple chapters, we were reminded to set our mind on things above, right? Not on things of the earth. We were called repeatedly through Colossians to live as the people we were called to be. Not just to go through life, but to be very intentionally putting to death the things that are of this world, the things that are of my flesh, to be putting on the things of Jesus Christ. That is, have you found that to be a lifelong process? For sure. God continues to work on that in me. Then we had the great challenge of letting the peace of Christ rule in our hearts and letting the Word of God dwell richly in us, in you, in all y'all. You know what I'm saying? And so, but then last message in Colossians, we were talking about how to relate to each other, how our marriage relationship, how our parenting child relationship, how our boss and subordinate relationships are all directed by our submission to Jesus Christ. This book is rich. I pray that it's going deep into our hearts and deep into our lives. Today, out of reverence for God's word and to remind us that it doesn't much matter what we think unless it's what God thinks, I want us to all stand together. And we're going to read, I will read the passage of scripture that we're into today from Colossians. If you've got Colossians open, chapter 4, starting in verse 2, I'll read. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear which is how I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Heavenly Father, we are standing out of respect, out of honor, recognizing that you have brought your word to our attention this morning. We want to be people who listen, who lean in, who submit, who live out the truth that you have called us to. We thank you, Lord, that we belong to you because of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, now speak to us through your word, we pray. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. Well, you know, we're a church family, right? So families know stuff about each other. You know stuff about your family. You know stuff nobody else knows, right? I'm going to let you in on a little secret about me because we're family. You know, I just want us to know each other. I'm kind of a chef, kind of a baker, sort of, maybe chef, baker, cooker. And I'm laughing, one of my friends in the room here is a chef. He's like, no, you are not. I have some recipes. I got some go-tos. I have more than one. I have less than three. But I have two recipes that are like, that's my thing at our house. Both pretty self-motivated. One is cookie dough, chocolate chip cookie dough. If it were up to me, it would get made and never baked. That's how it would go in my house. But my wife is good to me, and she bakes them. Cookie dough. And then the other one is pancakes. My wife is Norwegian, and so we make these, like, this really thin, like, I think they're actually called Swedish pancakes, but not at our house. They're called Norwegian pancakes. But I got the recipes, guys, for these. They're good. Thing is about a recipe is you need all the parts. You need them all, and you need them in the right proportion. And if you leave one out, it can be really, really problematic. I'm going to bake bread, not one of my recipes, but I'm going to bake bread, and I forget the yeast. How's that going? Not great. I'm going to make the cookies, but I forgot the sugar. Yeah, what's the point? Okay. So, today, we're going to look at God's Word, and it's on this topic. You'll see on your sermon notes there, the topic, the theme that we've titled it is Wisdom as You Witness. Wisdom as You Witness. Because God didn't save you just for you. He didn't save you just for all of the benefits, and there are so many benefits of being saved by Jesus Christ, but he didn't save you just for you. He saved you to be a witness, to tell the world about him. And so this passage has a bit of a recipe for us. I see four ingredients that need to be all a part of this recipe to see it accomplish the purpose for which God sent it. I'm going to give you the elements right now. If you're a blank filler-inner, you can get this done right now, and then hopefully you'll hang with us. But here they are. Here's the ingredients. To pray intentionally, to communicate clearly, to live wisely, and to speak graciously. Okay? To pray intentionally, to communicate clearly, to live wisely, and to speak graciously. Now, I don't want to just tell you that. I want to show you that from God's Word. So let's look at verse 2. First point here. Verse 2 says this, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, this is Paul writing, right? Pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison. The first part of this that I see is if we're going to be used of the Lord to share the good news of Jesus Christ with others, we have to pray intentionally, to pray intentionally. You know how to do things intentionally. There's no way you'd have been sitting in here by this time on a Sunday morning unless you did it intentionally. I want to be over there at that time, so I will do the things I need to do to be in the right place at the right time. Nice job. Prayer has to be that way. It won't be haphazard. It won't happen casually. Pray intentionally. Look at what God's Word says. I see three hows of prayer and then one what to pray for. Do you see them? The first one's this. Continue how? Steadfastly in prayer. Steadfastly. What's another word for steadfastly? Come on. I want to hear. Somebody, who's got a word? Anybody's fine. What was that? I still didn't hear you. I'm sorry. Persistently. Got it. Focused, determined, persistent, not letting go, staying focused, coming back at it again, unwavering. I can think of a person in our church, a dear woman, loved the Lord. Almost every time I saw her, pray for my child, I want them to know Jesus Christ. Pray for my child. I want them persistent, intentional, unwavering, steadfast prayer. You know, one of the things we've talked about in the church for years is that we believe in unceasing prayer. We need the Lord. I will not be able to accomplish his purpose unless I am intentional in the way I seek the Lord in prayer. So steadfastly, here's another how. Be watchful. Be watchful. I think there's a couple ways this works. I'm a dad, and you've heard me say I have all daughters, and so do you think I am watchful of young men? 100% yes. And so I remember not that long ago I was at a birthday party, a little co-ed party for one of my kids who was about this tall at the time, and this young man, nice young man, I ended up standing next to him, and he just looked up at me, he said, Mr. Learned, you're really big. I said, yes, I am. My kids are like, Dad. And I say, listen, honey, it's not my job to make young men feel comfortable around you. That's not my thing. So, but there's a certain way in which that's funny, but it's an appropriate watchfulness. I want to know who they're talking to. I want to know what's going on. So being watchful in prayer is being attentive. I'm paying attention. My head is up. My eyes are watching the landscape. I recognize that there's a real enemy. I recognize there are real threats. I recognize that the battle for someone's soul is a spiritual battle. So I'm going to be watchful in the way I pray. I think there's another way that watchful works. It's like this. I'm expectant. I believe this is going to happen. I'm watching for the day when they give their life to Jesus Christ. I'm watching for the opportunity that the Lord would give me to speak for Jesus Christ. Because if I'm praying intentionally and steadfastly and watchfully, you know what? I'm ready. I'm ready when the opportunity comes. And then there's another part there. With thanksgiving. Paul, how many times are you going to tell us with thanksgiving? We get it already. Why does he have to keep telling us this? Because we have to keep being told that. To pray with thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord, for the gospel. Thank you that I belong to you. Thank you that I'm not trying to sell my message. I'm trying to point people to Jesus Christ through your word. Thank you, Lord. So there's the hows. Now, what's the what? What are we called to pray for? Do you see it? Look at verse 3. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in chains. Wow. Okay. In prison, sorry, is the word. What is he praying for? What does Paul want more than anything else? First of all, where is he? In prison. Very clear, right? I would say that if I was in prison, I could see myself praying for an open door to my cell. Lord, I want out. Lord, this is awful. Lord, change this. What is he praying for? Well, maybe that's in there, but I think more so he's like, I want an opportunity. I want another opportunity to go speak boldly of my Savior, Jesus Christ. That's what he's praying for. That really challenges me because I pray for a lot of things, but sometimes I'm way too caught up in what I want to see happen for my sense of what's right or best, and I am not attentive enough to, Lord, would you please open a door where I get to speak for you? Paul knew what was going to happen. Why was he in prison? Because he had spoken for Christ so boldly. Lord, would you give me another opportunity to go get out of here, to go speak for Christ so I can come back here maybe? I don't know. But listen, the key part of that is he was disregarding his own well-being and saying, Lord, if I could be used for your agenda, that's what I want. That's what I'm praying for. This is bold, guys. And so simple questions. Just think about this personally. Am I praying? You don't have to answer me, but it's a really important question to answer. Am I praying? And then maybe right after that, how am I praying? What percentage of my prayer is about the things that are best for me, or what I think is best, or the people closest to me, and how much of it is, Lord, I want to be used for your purpose. I want to be your witness in a lost world. Am I praying? How am I praying? And then what am I praying for? I wish I could tell you every morning I wake up and I'm like, Lord, maybe today I get to share the gospel. Maybe today I get to tell about the mystery of Christ. I can't tell you I do that every day. I can tell you that when I do that, it is remarkable the conversations the Lord brings across my path. It's just when I'm praying, when I'm intentional, when I'm desirous, when I'm watchful, there are opportunities are everywhere. And as the followers of Jesus Christ, this is central to the mission he's called us to. This is necessary. I would just say under this whole thing, it's praying for an open door. Lord, would you give more opportunities for the gospel to be proclaimed with clarity? And that leads us to the second thing. Second ingredient here is what? Communicate clearly. Communicate clearly. You see what it says in verse 4? It says, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Now, I got to tell you, when I read that, I'm like, that's clear. That doesn't need I don't think I need to explain that. But I just want to challenge and press us a little bit that as we're praying for an open door, I think we need to also be praying and ready with an open mouth. With an open mouth. Well, I think they see my Christian t-shirts and my, you know, bumper sticker and maybe. but are we speaking for Christ, that we're communicating clearly as we ought to speak? I simply would just say, is your witness audible? Well, I just try to be a really good person at work, and hopefully they know, they put two and two together. I go to church, I love Jesus, maybe we'll get to a minute the importance of your life, your character, your behavior, but there is something God calls us to communicate clearly as I ought to speak. We have to open our mouth. We have to speak of the gospel of Jesus Christ so audibly. Another part of that is biblically, to speak biblically. You know what, Dave, the thing is, I'm just a little afraid, if I'm honest, that once I get into that conversation, I'm not going to know what to say. I really understand that. I have lived a lot of years in that. I still live in that. I don't know. Speak biblically. I say this all the time. My words are not living and active. God's words are living and active. They accomplish the purpose for which they're sent. And maybe for some of us today, the thing we got to do is be like, I have to have two or three verses that are on my tongue, on my heart, on my mind, that I can just share them. And I can let the Holy Spirit use that the way he wants to use that. He doesn't actually, this is a bit of a newsflash, he doesn't actually need us. Do you get that? He's not advantaged by me in any way. He gives us the privilege of being an ambassador for Christ and speaking his message. Here's one biblical truth that helps us in sharing our faith. Romans 1:16 says this. Listen, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to who? To everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. If I put my confidence in what I have to say, that's sketchy. If I put my confidence in what God has to say, that's solid. That's not gonna shift. That will be used for his purpose. So audibly, biblically, and then I would just say, how can I communicate clearly? Personally. Just do it personally. Well, I don't know if I have all the right things memorized. It's okay. Do it personally. Tell your story. Here's a way that we've taught in our church to tell your story. A couple categories, okay? What's your story? I was far from Christ. I was proud of myself. I was self-righteous. I was whatever, okay? We all have a story. But God is the second part. God stepped in. God opened my eyes. God brought me low. I could watch that baptism of Ricardo all week long. What did he say? He said, I went away from the Lord and the church, but God stepped in. I was at my son's house. We were talking about the Lord. We were talking about the Word. I gave my life to him. I was, but God. And then what's the last part? And now. I'm a different person. I don't care about the same things. I don't do the same things. God has changed me from the inside out. Loved ones, if we're going to communicate clearly, it's got to be audible. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. It's got to be biblical. God's words. That's what gets his agenda done. And then it's got to be personal. Let me tell you my story. Wherever possible, speak God's word. The power is in the message. It's not in the messenger. It's always in the message. All right, we got two ingredients. Done? Good recipe? Now let's add a couple more. Here's a third one. To live wisely. To live wisely. We're called to live wisely. Look at verse 5. It says, walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. All right, I think I get this. Walk, what is walk? Well, walk is a term that's used, Paul uses it repeatedly. It's your life, it's your behaviors, it's your choices, it's your word, it's the way people see you. How are you walking? Where are you going? What is the manner of the way you relate to other people? We're called in this passage to walk in wisdom toward who? What's it say? Walk in wisdom toward outsiders. Who's the outsiders? Oh, it's those outsiders. No, listen, he's writing to Christians. He's writing to the church. So outsiders would be people who don't yet know the Lord. They've never given their life to Jesus Christ. What are we supposed to do? We're supposed to walk in wisdom towards them. All right, so what is that? I believe it's our words. I think it's our actions. I think it's our attitudes. So last night, we finished the church and this message, and my wife and I went to the store to buy some things, and It's a long story, but it just wasn't working out at the cash register quite the way I thought it was supposed to work out, and I was kind of, is it okay to be a little bit annoyed? I was a little bit annoyed. It's probably as much my fault. And I just was like, in that moment, the Lord's like, walk with wisdom. Walk with wisdom. What are you going to represent right here? You going to represent what you think is right, or are you going to represent the way I would want you to represent? And yeah, great, no problem. That's going to work out great. I don't get this right all the time, but we have to be growing, loved ones, in the ability to walk in wisdom towards outsiders, carrying forth God's character in his agenda. Just a simple question. What is your reputation with outsiders? How do they view you? Do they view you as authentic? Do they view you as loving, as kind, as gracious, as generous? I mean, these are the characteristics of our Lord, right? And so I need to be walking in wisdom, because walking in wisdom authenticates the message that I want to share. I can't have a dissonance where my life is representing something other than what the Lord would want, and then I'm going to, what, then I'm going to speak for Christ? No, this is the authentication that makes it real to lost people. It's a demonstration of real faith in a loving God, okay? Walking in wisdom towards outsiders. And then there's this phrase, do you see it? Making the best use of the time. I didn't wear a watch today. Anybody know what time it is? Anybody got it? You're like, time for you to finish? No, just, it's 10:03 on this clock right here. It says 10:03. All right. That's not really what I mean. What I mean is, what time is it? Where are you? Where am I in our timeline of opportunities to get done what God gave us to get done? I was working on this message, thinking about it on Friday, and I got a text. Hey, Dave, wanted you to know my dad is now with the Lord. Well, we've been praying for that man. He loved the Lord. He'd been facing some really tough physical things, and guess what? On Friday, his faith became sight. He's with the Lord. Awesome. I had another text later in that day. Hey, want to show you the picture of our little girl born today. Awesome. Awesome. And it just makes me think. Psalm 90 verse 12 says, teach us, O Lord, to number our days that we would get a heart of wisdom. It's kind of a fascinating concept to me. So I would just like you to quick write down the number of your days. Now, you don't know. We just had a birthday in our house this week. Did you know that you can ask Siri, how many days has it been since this date, and it will tell you? Don't do it now, but do it later. It's very fun. So we were doing this with our whole family. How many days have I lived? Well, how many days do I have? I have the number of days the Lord ordains. That's how many I have. What am I going to do with that? Well, I have a number of opportunities that he can bring across my path. The question is, what am I going to do with that? Am I making the best use of the time? I was joking with another young dad this morning how we're running kids to this practice and that thing and this thing. And I said, I don't know that I make any decisions. I just go places, you know? And it's very easy, whether that's your season of life or there's other things going on, to just get distracted or to get weighed down or just to get we're called to make the best use of the time for the Lord, okay? To make the best use of the time. The phrase, one commentator I read said this, it's buying up the opportunity. Buying up the opportunity. You like to get a good opportunity? Bunch of garage sales in my neighborhood this week. I just drove past them all. No thanks. But I know some people really like those. Here's an opportunity. Did you know that if you would have taken this opportunity in the year 2000 of buying stock in a little company called Apple, if you'd have bought $500 worth of shares 19 years ago, do you know what it's worth today? A lot, yes, very good answer. $22,000, okay? The thing that's funny to me about investing, I'd like to do it in reverse. Like, yeah, I want in on that now. Now that I know that that's what's gonna, it just doesn't always happen like that, though. But why do I bring up the investing? Because it's a stewardship. It's a trust. When God has changed your heart, when God has changed you from the inside out and called you his own, he says, I'm entrusting this to you. Make the best use of your time. Buy up the opportunities. How am I going to be ready for those? I'm going to pray for those. I'm going to watch for those. I'm going to ask for those. And when it comes, I'm going to speak as clearly as I know how, God's truth. Okay? Here's a couple of verses on this point of stewardship. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 6. Matthew 6, he says, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth." Man, we get caught in this sometimes, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. "But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." You want to talk about ROI? You want to talk about return on investment? That is a proven plan for laying up treasures in heaven. It won't fail. It will be rewarded. I can put into an account somehow, God says, laying up treasures in heaven. It actually says for yourself. That's not the point of this message, but listen, what am I doing with my opportunities? They're coming all the time. They're coming all the time. And we need to be ready. We need to live wisely towards outsiders, making the best use of the time. One more on this point of stewardship is 1 Corinthians 4. Look at this. Again, this is Paul writing. "This then is how you ought to regard us, as servants of Christ and as those entrusted with what? The mysteries God has revealed. Now, it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful." You've been entrusted with the gospel. You've been blessed if you've been saved by Jesus Christ. What are you doing to steward that? What am I doing to steward that? There are opportunities all around us. I've got to believe that wherever you go all week long at work, there's people who don't know the Lord. It's not so much true for me and my work, but you know what I'm saying, where you're at. And then we go to, I was talking to a guy this morning. I'm coaching my kids' soccer team. Yeah, awesome. I'll bet you're interacting with parents there. You know, I've got teachers in my kids' school. I've got neighbors. I've got loved ones. There are opportunities everywhere. And Lord, forgive us. Lord, forgive me. We get so tunnel visioned and so on a track and on a program that I'm not praying for, I'm not longing for, I'm not watching for, I'm not speaking up when there are opportunities to speak for Christ. This verse just says, hey, live wisely, because your life can authenticate the message you want to share. Okay? All right, one more point. One more ingredient. Got to have them all. Last one is this: to speak graciously. To speak graciously. Verse 6 says this: "Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person." Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Just help me with this. How many of my words are to be gracious? Yeah, how much of the time should my words be gracious? That's pretty clear. What does that mean? Grace is, we always say this, grace is unmerited favor. I don't know if you did the checkout register thing right or not. And I might be right or not, but I can be gracious, right? I can speak graciously. I can give the benefit of the doubt. And by the way, this is not compromising on truth. You know, we're called in Ephesians to speak the truth in love. I heard somebody say one time, if you can't speak the truth in a loving way, it's not yet time to speak the truth. I thought that was good. That helps me. To be people with speech who is always gracious, and then what? Seasoned with salt. What is going on there? Well, I don't know. Last night we drove home, we bought some food. It included some French fries. Okay, just real quick, French fries with salt or without salt? For sure with salt, for sure. It was really good. So why salt? It makes it savory. It makes it appetizing. It makes it enticing. It makes it flavorful. You should be looking for opportunities to use our words graciously, because I've been given grace, because God is gracious to me. And I should be looking for opportunities to season my speech with salt. I just think simply this is referencing the Lord. This is speaking of who you love. You know, wow, you sure got it lucky. No, I don't have it lucky, but I have a really good God. He's been super faithful to me. You know, I just think there's so many ways that we can. Let me tell you what this scripture says. Let me tell you this verse I just read. To be seasoned with salt is to looking for ways to interspersed to speak of Christ while we are relating to people who don't yet know him. And then this might be the scariest part of the passage, depending on your personality. So that you may know how you ought to answer each person. This is the thing, isn't it? You're like, okay, I'm with you to here, Dave. I want to pray. I want to look for open doors. I want to have an open mouth. But I am a little scared that I'm going to get partway into a conversation and get a question that I can't quite answer. Well, what about this? Well, what about that? Do you know what? God's word is sufficient. You can trust it. And I think we hesitate sometimes because we're afraid of that very scenario. I don't want to get to a spot where I don't know what to say next or I can't answer their question. Can I just give a little encouragement in this? Can I just encourage you to answer simply and answer honestly, okay? I don't know if I can fully unpack everything you just said, but can I tell you what I know? Can I tell you what God's word says? Can I tell you what I know to be true because I've read it and I've seen it and I've lived it? Again, simply, honestly, biblically. You know, I have had many situations with someone where I'll say, you know, I don't know if I can give you an awesome answer about that. Here's some things I know to be true. Would you be open to the two of us looking at that question to see what God's word says about it? I'd love to study that more. Would you do that with me? Because then people aren't building their hope in you, Mr. Answer Man. They're building their hope in the Lord who gave us a book that reveals the mysteries of Christ, okay? To know how to answer each person. And then I would just say again, answer personally. I love this. So it's been said many times. God doesn't need an attorney. He needs a witness, okay? He doesn't need somebody to make his argument for him. He doesn't need somebody to prop up the facts in a compelling way. He needs somebody to say, I was lost. God intervened. God has changed me from the inside out. I would love for you to know what he wants to do for you. He offers grace. He offers forgiveness. He offers reconciliation with a holy God. Just to speak personally, okay? When do we do this? When? Well, whenever the opportunity comes. When do the opportunities come? Can I just share some observations, what we've seen? I have seen so many times opportunities to speak for Christ, to point people to Christ come, sometimes at points of pain. Loss. I lost a loved one. I lost the job. I lost the opportunity. I lost the relationship. Why then are we ready? Because we realize what I thought I had going wasn't going and it isn't going to last and I need hope beyond the loss that I've experienced. People are more tender at that time. Another thing is when things are new, you know, a new baby, parents are like, oh man, now what? I probably ought to do something for them about faith. I've seen this a lot of times. People start to get serious about their own faith because they realize they're going to pass something on to their kids. A new marriage is like this. We have all the answers about marriage, and then we get married. You know, and you're like, oh, looks like this is a little more challenging maybe than what I thought. Maybe I could get some help. Maybe the Lord can lead me. I've watched this couple in my neighborhood. They seem to sincerely love each other. They seem to be real and working things out. They seem to have a faith in God. I'd like to hear what they have to say, okay? Seasons of pain, new seasons, new jobs, new neighbors. Super proud of my mother-in-law. She's getting ready to move, and she told me, she goes, man, I'm just actually kind of getting excited. I'm going to meet some neighbors. I hope I can encourage them. I hope I can, you know, speak about the Lord. It's like, awesome, awesome. By the way, I think we're going to head into a few months now where we can actually be outside. And I'm amazed, I'm not going to say for sure, but I'm amazed that the neighbors I haven't talked to in 4 or 5 months, I'm talking to them again. And this is a great time at the park, at the ball game, out in your neighborhood, at the, even if you go to a garage sale, I won't judge, it's great. Loved ones, look for the opportunities. It boils down to this, I want to be used by you, God. I want to be used by you. You have done so much for me. I can't believe that you saved me. I can't believe it. Why? Well, for his glory and for his agenda. And now I have this opportunity. I have this trust to speak for Christ. This passage gives us these super helpful practical things. Pray intentionally. Communicate clearly, live wisely, and speak graciously. Now, if I could just tell you a little bit about some things we're thinking about at church. We've had some great conversations around this passage in the last 10 days with our staff. And we're so compelled by these thoughts to continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. And at the same time, praying that God would open a door for the word. What else would matter than that? I just believe that this is a season when we have an opportunity to speak for Christ. I think it's the time of year. I think it's the time in our church. I think it's a time when the Lord is going to stir all of us to be less internal and how am I doing with each other and more like I have a mission to fulfill that's been given by God. Now, what I've observed in this is that rarely does that fire for the gospel, that fire for mission, get stoked in isolation. Have you observed this? Rarely, sometimes, but rarely is it me just sitting there, and even with God's word, he does provoke that, but 10 times more, he provokes that when we're in community with each other. The reason we have what we have is so that we can go share it with other people. So I just want you to know that we're really thinking about this as a campus and as a church. One of the things that will help, hopefully help, even as you're thinking through and praying through this week, we made a little bookmark. Everybody say, thanks, Dave. I didn't make it. It was a thanks, though. This little bookmark is just a review of the points of the message. And on the back is a spot that says witness. Let's pray for an open door, an open mouth to open hearts. Okay? Do you believe that God cares about that? 100%. I need to care more about that. We need to care more about that and to be intentionally praying. I have faith to believe that if we take this word seriously, if we act upon it personally and together, we're going to have a line outside of a baptism tank. And it won't be saying the church did whatever. It'll be saying my neighbor. It'll be saying my sister. It'll be saying my teacher. It'll be saying my coach pointed me to Jesus Christ. It opened my eyes. I gave my life to him. So take that. That's going to be available as you leave today. Just let that provoke you to be prayerful about that. We've offered a couple times, we're going to offer again a class on witness. How do I share my faith? Well, we would love to have you involved with that, to learn, to get better at the ability to share your faith personally. We're going to do a little, I heard about this in the last 10 days, we're going to do a little podcast with little 5-minute things on witness, you know, how to have a conversation about the Lord, how to point people to Jesus Christ. We just want to put tools in our hands because the church doesn't exist to meet on Sunday mornings or Saturday night. The church exists to fulfill the mission that Jesus Christ gave us of proclaiming the gospel. Now, as a church family, you got to know that this is a summer where we're going to have some great things. High Five is going to be amazing. Camp is going to be amazing. But we're really trying not to add 18 more calendar things. What we'd really love is for the church to be prayerful about these things and to be stoking the fire together of where does the Lord want us to reach out. And I would just tell you, more details coming, but through some of the giving that's been done to the Closer campaign, every one of our campuses, including Rolling Meadows, will have really a cool opportunity of resource, and it will be specifically for the purpose of how do we reach our community? How do we reach people who don't yet know Jesus Christ? So please, I say that now because I want you to pray about that. We're praying about that. Lord, show us. What's the opportunity? What's the way? What do you want us to do? But personally and collectively, here's what it boils down to. This is an awesome season to lean in to the Lord. I've heard so many people say, my time in the Word, my prayer life has been more vibrant than any I can remember. Awesome. God redeems. He uses hard circumstances for his glory. Lean into God, lean into each other, okay? We got to do this together, guys, and lean into our mission. I love to gather for worship, but this is to get us motivated, focused, and ready to go out and go minister to people in the name of Jesus Christ. All right, I'm going to close with this. Famous quote from a famous poem by a guy named C.T. Studd. He was British. He was a missionary to China in the late 1800s. Listen to this. Here's what he said, part of a poem he wrote. Only one life, will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Lord, help us to be focused on the mission, focused on what he's given us, to be people who would be praying for, looking for, ready for an open door for the word, for the mystery of Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Lord, we take such confidence because your word speaks truth. Your word reveals who you are. Your word tells us what matters and how you want it to get done. Lord, I really don't understand why you would pick people like us to carry forth your message, but I believe it's this, that the surpassing power belongs to God and not of us. Would you help us, Lord, even in this moment, that we would be praying for, asking for, watching for the opportunity to speak for you. Lord, Paul was quite a model. He wasn't concerned about how that would work out for him. He was ultimately concerned that God would be glorified, and I pray that it would be true in our lives. Lord, I want to pray that in this season, in this summer of ministry, we would be drawing near to you, the living God. We would be drawing near to each other, considering how to stir up one another in these things. And Lord, we won't presume upon it, but I by faith believe we're going to see people coming to faith in Jesus Christ as we're faithful to proclaim your word and the mystery of Jesus Christ. Lord, all of this can be done in your strength. None of this can be done in our own. Lead us forward now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.